I have no financial disclosure with any of the products or things being discussed in this presentation. I'll be talking about refractive lens exchange and the IOL options in this kind of a situation. So when do we need to think about refractive lens exchange? I would look at it in a situation like this. I had a 26-year-old male who's a software engineer. He came in for an ICL surgery, but the ACD was below the acceptable limit. He had been using glasses for close to 20 years. No other significant ocular or systemic history, and no medications or any other problems systemically. The refractive error was about 20 diopters in one eye, myopia, and minus 14 with 2.5 cylinder in the other eye. Best corrected, improving only to 6.24 in both eyes with glasses or contact lenses. So what was my option? I would think that this individual is a poor candidate for LASIK of any sort, or any corneal procedure of any sort. The phakic IOL, because of the chamber depth, becomes a problem. So the only option for this kind of an individual is, in terms of surgery, is a refractive lens exchange, clear lens extraction, or refractive lens tubing. Terminology is multiple terminologies, basically meaning the same thing. So who are the candidates for this one? Individuals where the myopia is very high and the poor candidates for LASIK or phakic lens. Hyperopic, beyond the acceptable limits for, again, the corneal or phakic IOL procedures. Where there is a high regular corneal astigmatism, where there may be lenticular astigmatism or dysfunctional lens syndromes. It's very important at the outset to explain to them, counsel them, and set their expectations in terms of what they will be achieving. Because if we are going with very high myopic individuals, we may find that we will not be able to give them a range of vision. We will be able to, we will be immediately making them iatrogenic presbyopia. So it's very important for them to understand what they are getting into. We are going to give them good distance best corrected vision. And we need to make them understand all the available options, including non-surgical options like spectacles or contact lenses. The risks and complications and the benefits of each of these also need to be explained properly. We have a specific special informed consent for this one, which runs into almost 3.5 pages and is available in English as well as a few of the local languages to make sure that the patient is able to understand what they're getting into. We talk about what the procedure is, what are the risks and benefits, what are the alternatives, the financial implications, chance of complications, and then take the specific consent after initialing all the pages. So, in most of these individuals, topical anesthesia is what is preferred, as minimal invasive as possible. In refractive lens exchange, a femtosecond platform is desirable, though not necessary. The capsular axis need to be perfectly centered and just giving adequate overlap of the IOL optic. If the rexus is too small, you may have a small hyperopic shift. If the rexus is too large, it is possible that there is lens decentration tilt or potential for VCOs. And alteration in the effective lens position would undermine, would reduce the predictability of the target eye refraction. Astigmatism correction, if the correction is possible within the range of the IOL powers available that Dr. Himanshu will be talking about later, can be done at the level of the IOL itself. Otherwise, it's somewhat less predictable. It can be done with liberal relaxing incisions, and this is where I think the femtosecond platform has a role, where we can do femto-assisted astigmatic keratotomies a little more predictably. What is the lens that we would, what is the formula that we would use? There are many choices available. The traditional one, which has been there for quite some time, is in shorter eyes, the Hopper cube, or the high Haggis, or the Holiday cube. In normal size IOLs, in normal size eyes, say axial length of 22, 23, 24, SRKT, Haggis, Holiday all work very well. If the eyeball is longer, greater than 24, move slowly towards the apex of the holiday, and if it is very long, then probably the apex is the best. Recently, Barrett and Olson have come out with formulae which are supposed to be universal formulae and work well irrespective of the axial length. And in about 80 to 90% of cases, their Barrett formula gives within 0.5 diopters of target refraction. So, when I was training 15 years back, they say never do a clear lens extraction because there is associated risk of retinal detachment and complications, PCO rates were high, etc. But today, as we are able to consistently deliver a more technically perfect surgery, the chance of complications has become less, and the from a 30% need for capsulotomy in 2003 complications, we have been able to reduce that quite a lot. And the retinal detachment rates after cataract extraction in routine uncomplicated cases is low, though it can be as high as 20% if there is either an intraoperative nodular dialysis or a posterior capsule rupture. Now we are able to reduce the 20% rate to almost 1.8%, which is the expected retinal detachment rate in the lifetime of an individual who is high myopic. It is not more than the natural course of high myopia. So modern surgical techniques, IOLs and appropriate technology, this should be offered, is what the 2005 article says. In terms of hypropia, spherically equivalent refraction outcome and best surgical, best corrected spectacle vision were similar for both Fatigue IOLs and refractive lens exchange. The risk in hyprops is basically the chance that the anterior chamber is very shallow, and if we are able to maintain that space, we will be okay. In terms of astigmatism, the presence of higher degrees of toric intraocular lenses and the availability of the femto-assisted astigmatic keratotomies has improved the efficacy of the technology. So IOL options is basically monofocals. With monofocals we can plan for some amount of monovision, and that gives a very acceptable alternative to multifocal IOLs without any of the dysphotopsias associated with multifocals. Toric IOLs correct astigmatism. Multifocals have been there and have rapidly evolved, and now we have bifocal IOLs also to reduce the dysphotopsias and improve the range of vision. Accommodative IOLs and newer IOLs are potentially there, but we discuss them one by one. When it comes to high myopia, my personal choice, no financial disclosure here, is up to minus 5 we have the Actisoft Expand series, and beyond minus 5 to minus 10 is the Sensar from AMO. Lots of other lenses are available in the market, though I have personally less experience with them. When it comes to high hyperopia, my personal choice again happens to be the Actisoft single piece lens, which goes up to plus 40, and then the Bausch & Vista, which is also there in that range. In terms of toric IOLs, it will be discussed a little more in detail by Dr. Himanshu, so I'll just briefly touch on them. It is important to mark the steep axis in the sitting position so that there is no cyclotorsion. Then that is called as a reference marking, and the intraoperative axis alignment is to be done. A misalignment of about 1 degree reduces about 3.5% of the cylindrical power. So for low cylindrical powers it is not such an issue, but for higher the cylinder power, if you let's say going for a T9 or something like that, then that becomes a problem. A T9 which is available on the Actisoft platform is designed to correct 6 diopters, so even small rotation becomes an issue. The Technis platform, which is again very stable, is available to about 3.5 diopters, and other lenses are also there. Though my personal experience is maximum with the Actisoft and the Technis platforms. So what is monovision? Monovision is a method whereby you can give good range. Preoperatively, we check and see, determine the dominant eye. Preferably, the dominant eye should have distance correction and the non-dominant eye should have near correction. And in 2015 Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery article, we have a paper which says that monovision and multifocal IOL implantation both provide excellent refractive outcomes. The multifocal IOL insertion was associated with less dependence on glasses compared to monovision, but significantly over dysphotopsias. So if you have an individual who is susceptible to dysphotopsias, night driving, etc., monovision should be the choice that is offered first compared to multifocal IOLs. Interesting component is suggested in ACRS in 2011 was something called as hybrid monovision, which is where you correct the distant dominant eye for a single monofocal IOL and give a multifocal lens in the near dominant eye. And this was also supposed to be a hybrid monovision could be something which needs to be considered in certain individuals. Multifocal IOLs since 2000 odd, when I started doing multifocals, have improved in leaps and bounds, and refractive has given way slowly to diffractive multifocals, and then today the diffractive multifocals are available from both AMO and Alcon, and several other Indian companies also have slowly given way to what is called as the trifocal lenses, which reduce the dip in the defocus curve at intermediate ranges. So basically what are they doing in trifocal lenses? They are trying to give two different diffractive structures. The first diffractive structure, the zero order diffraction, gives you good far vision. The first order diffraction gives you good near vision, and beyond that, second order, third order, etc., gives you a lot of additional power, which is basically lost light and which contributes to the dysphotopsias. The second diffractive structure is for far vision, and the step height is determined such that the first order diffraction gives you good intermediate vision, and the multiple of that, the second order diffraction, gives you good near vision. And so this allows a significant reduction in the amount of energy that is lost. The amount of dysphotopsias that happen is also very much lesser, and the dip in the defocus curve in conventional multifocals is eliminated. What happens if the individual has astigmatism along with high myopia or high hyperopia? There are lenses which correct from minus 10 to plus 24 and to higher for the plus powers also, with a toric lens incorporated into them, which correct up to plus 10 to 12 diopters of cylinder also. Another option which may come in the future, these are lenses which came into the market, disappeared, coming into the market again, accommodative lenses. They hold the potential for eliminating the dysphotopsias associated with multifocals, and promising lenses on the scene are the Synchrony and the Aqualens, both of which are in clinical trials. Newer lenses which have been there in all the textbooks for several years. One of them which has come into the market recently is the light adjustable lens. I'd like to share with you another case, which is a 20-year-old male who came in for surgery, was using glasses for 18 years. Almost from pediatric age, he was using glasses. He was plus 16 in one eye, plus 15 in the other eye. This is the biometry. He required about 48 diopters in both eyes. What were my options? So I did a stage surgery. I did a refractive lens exchange using a plus 40 Alcon single piece in both eyes. Residual refraction after that was plus 7.5 in both eyes. And then I did a piggyback ICH for the hyperopia. And post that, the refraction was plano in one eye and small myopia intended in the other eye to be black medium monovision. So this is where the concept of piggyback IOLs come in. First IOL is in the back, the second IOL is placed in the back or in the sulcus. Sulcoplex is one of the models. I'll be showing a video of that one. concerned with initial models of piggyback lenses, especially when both were placed into the bag, was that there could be collection of your Sommering slit kind of material and interlenticular fibrosis and opacification could happen. These are the light-rate adjustable lenses which are finally, after 20-25 years of research, come into the market. It is commercially available in several countries in Europe but not in India. You place basically any IOL into the eye which corresponds close to the required refraction of the patient, and then post-operatively, 2 weeks after surgery, you lock the refraction if everything is perfect, or you irradiate the IOL to eliminate the residual refractive error, and then 24 hours after that confirm that the correction has been appropriate and then lock it in. Only problem is that the locking is done by ultraviolet light, and so for the 2-3 weeks till the final locking happens, the patient needs to be protected from ultraviolet light. That means needs to wear the some form of UV protection, otherwise there can be accidental, just exposure to sunlight can cause accidental locking in, and that could cause a problem. Thank you.